As a child, I was impressed by the legend of the flood. The life of our civilization was coming to an end. The days of the people were numbered. The water level rose higher and higher, and the last of the people on the mountain peaks were drenched in rain. People who were punished for disobeying an angry deity didn't know their guilt. They just wanted to live, they just loved their children. They just wanted to go back to their homes. From a scientific point of view, all the water on the planet isn't enough to drown all. But what, by and large, is the difference between them and us? After all, could you survive if a monstrous element flooded your city, your country, or an entire continent? Or would the fate of Noah be waiting for only a lucky few? It happened on the morning of December 26, 2004, 100 miles west of the island of Sumatra. Millions of years leading up to this day, an ancient confrontation between giants had gone unnoticed. The Indian plate, once part of Gondwana, had been pressing with increasing force on the neighboring Eurasian plate. She was squeezing it and trying to push it up from a depth of 19 miles until the growing tension shot out like a compressed spring. The ancient gigantic plates slipped relative to each other, and the monstrous impact of the sea floor was thrown up and arched up several feet for almost 1,000 miles. The point where the cataclysm occurred is part of the Pacific Ring of Fire. More than 80% of the largest earthquakes on the planet occur here, and tectonic plate shifts have occurred regularly over several centuries. However, at that time, there was no system for early detection of a tsunami in the Indian Ocean or a procedure for notifying the population in coastal areas. Carefree tourists continued to enjoy sunbathing on golden sand, playing with children, and diving into the breathtaking and safe ocean. Huge masses of water received this earthquake of incredible strength and moved from the epicenter toward the coast. Ted Morty, the ex-president of the Tsunami Society, estimated the total energy of these waves at 5 megatons in TNT equivalent. This is twice the real power of all the ammunition detonated during the Second World War, including two atomic bombs. But the wave height didn't exceed 20 inches in the first hours after the quake. Meeting such a wave in the open ocean, a ship wouldn't even have felt the pitching. But when the front of the tide began to slow down on the shallow coastal water, the height of the wave increased sharply with each passing moment. By the time the residents of the coast and tourists saw the incredibly monstrous wave and realized that it was bringing death to all living things, its height had reached 50 feet. This water monster struck an unexpected blow on the coasts of Indonesia, Sri Lanka, India, Thailand, and other countries. People relaxing on the warm sand under the hot sun, sleeping under the air conditioning of their rooms, and making their choices on the menu before breakfast at a local restaurant were all caught off guard. In the first seconds, the dark gray wall of water demolished the beach of sun chairs and umbrellas with ease, without any resistance. Within a minute or two, it was crushing overpasses, hurling cars, destroying artificial metal and concrete. It didn't even matter who could swim better. The flood of overturned cars uprooted palm trees, and thousands of tons of smaller debris swallowed everything in its path, dragging it several miles inland and dumping everything there, regardless of the twisted metal and corpses. An hour after the catastrophe, those lucky enough to survive the first killer blow continued to die without medical attention, in destroyed buildings, under fallen trees, and from their injuries, just lying in the mud. Only a day later was first aid able to break through the garbage barricades built by the giant wave and help those who managed to survive. After that, it was estimated that 300,000 people drowned on the coast, were left under the rubble of buildings, or were crushed by the flood. Some of them were never found and are considered missing. The greedy ocean must have taken their bodies when the water receded. It's a tragedy, but such a tsunami cannot threaten all of humanity, only certain regions. But what if the source of the wave isn't an earthquake but something more terrible? This is the ancient crater Chicxulub. Its monstrous size is 112 miles in diameter, and its original depth is up to 12 miles. It was formed almost 67 million years ago when an asteroid with a diameter of more than 6 miles crashed into the peninsula known to us as the Yucatan at great speed. The impact power of the asteroid is estimated at 100 teratons in TNT equivalent, which is exactly 1 million times the earthquakes in the Indian Ocean. How would you like the size of a tsunami, 160 feet high or 330? It isn't easy to imagine the consequences of waves that could sweep across continents from end to end across the planet. But one thing is clear, the survivors would be few, and it's not guaranteed that they would be happy under the conditions of their new life. Now, look carefully. After all, the asteroid just fell on the shore, and the volume of water thrown out was very small. If it had hit the open ocean, for example, in the Mariana Trench, the depth of which is precisely the size of the asteroid, it would be as if they were created for each other. We would now be in the same situation as the dinosaurs were. Yes, a tsunami is a monstrous, deadly disaster, but its impact is instantaneous, and afterward, humanity has time to restore its strength and take some measures. For example, it is building an early tsunami detection system to evacuate coastal areas rapidly. But there may be more terrifying flood scenarios when the water level rises for a long time or forever. In 2015, NASA experts have shown that the level of the world's ocean is growing faster than expected, and in the coming decades, it will rise by 3 feet if the warming trend continues. The glaciers at the poles of our planet will continue to melt, causing the world's ocean level to rise continuously as all the ice on the Earth turns into liquid. Here's a map of the continents in the future. At first glance, the land may appear the same as before, but as we approach Asia, the scale of the tragedy becomes clear. Huge cities like Kolkata and Shanghai, with a combined population of almost 19 million, will be swallowed up by the ocean. The natural catastrophe will occur in densely populated areas of Southeast Asia, including China, Bangladesh, and Indonesia. Territories with more than a billion inhabitants will be submerged underwater. The annual reduction of land will present new challenges to humanity, the area of arable land will decrease, and there will no longer be enough food for humanity. New ocean expanses will increase the humidity of the atmosphere. Through evaporation, these expanses will lead to eternal rains that will flood the crowded cities of the continents. However, there is also good news: the rising water levels and land flooding will occur over decades or even centuries. This allows us to take timely action and ensure the possibility of survival on the remaining smaller territory. Most likely, this will be enforced through birth control, mass production of chemical food, and the construction of new multi-tiered cities. Of course, humanity considers itself safe when contemplating possible apocalypse scenarios, which often involve pandemics or world wars, but rarely a flood. However, various ancient civilizations, such as the Sumerians, Greeks, Arabs, Hindus, and Chinese, were aware of such floods, even without direct communication among them. This shared knowledge across millennia raises questions about the likelihood of such an event occurring again. We now understand that the formidable power of waves and food scarcity in condensed and overpopulated areas pose severe threats to humanity during tsunamis and floods. However, we create even more hazardous factors, not nature. Throughout history, humanity has devised various ways of survival, and I will now present two recent examples. This footage depicts the 2011 tsunami in Japan that claimed about 18,000 lives. Many survivors were cut off from essential resources like fresh water and electricity. Despite these hardships, the affected communities displayed remarkable solidarity, with virtually no crime incidents. Mutual assistance and a sense of social responsibility prevailed, ensuring fair distribution of food and resources. Conversely, in the aftermath of Hurricane Katrina in 2005, 80% of New Orleans was flooded, and chaos ensued. Most residents had been evacuated, but those who remained faced a different danger: human violence. Groups of looters took advantage of the situation, leading to an atmosphere of lawlessness. This incident underscores the importance of maintaining social order and values even in the face of catastrophe. Therefore, if we seek to be prepared for an apocalypse, whether a flood or any other disaster, our initial focus should not solely be stockpiling supplies like fuel and food or mastering survival skills like hunting and water sourcing. Instead, we must first ask ourselves, are we a community that builds civilization upon mutual support, or are we predators who exploit the weak? Please share your opinions in the comments, but always remember that the actual test of our nature occurs in practice, and its revelations may surprise us.